I am pleased and proud to open the afternoon session on of the Conference on Languages. When Yadin suggested the idea to me, I said, languages? No, language. And in fact, that sort of will be the theme of the afternoon session, which is called here Languages of Humans, and which linguists usually refer to as natural languages, and that in itself says a lot. And the idea of language versus languages, or slash languages, not versus, is very, very deeply entrenched in linguistic theory and thinking. For the last 100 years at least, the question to which of language with a capital L as all embracing, and languages as talking about differentiation, variation, and variability. And I think that there is almost no one better to talk on this topic than our first speaker, Professor Jan-Ola Östman from Finland, from the University of Helsinki. It will take me all the time of the session to talk about all his many achievements, so I'll just say that he is Scandinavian, as you can hear from his name, but he studied at leading universities, receiving degrees in England, in Britain, and at the University of California in Berkeley, where he did his PhD. And he is a key person in talking about the balance between the study of universal and interlanguage variation and variability. He has conducted far-reaching research and innovative research, both in capital L and in different languages. Leading proponent of construction grammar, I think he is the first and perhaps one of the only people to have suggested that construction grammar, the construction grammar idea, be applied not only to sentences and constructions, but also to discourse, whole pieces of discourse as constructions. He has published extensively on discourse analysis and cross-linguistic research, and among his many other honors, he is currently the president of the International Pragmatics Association, and I'm pleased and honored to invite you, Jan-Ola.
Thank you so very much. I'm extremely honored and pleased to be here. It's my first visit ever to Israel, and in particular, well, thanks to the Academy and to Professor Ruth Berman and to my colleague in Haifa, Brachanir. I'm going to take you into the humanities now more, and I've been asked to open this session on human languages from any entry point whatsoever of my choosing, and my title indicates what perspectives I want to pursue. I want to give the yin and yang of language, of the rules and the variation of variability, and look at how we can restrain linguistic diversity in our analytic attempts at describing and explaining the interplay between language, cognition, interaction, and culture. And since I presume most of you or many of you are not linguists here, I feel I should maybe say something general about linguistics or language the way linguists or some linguists see it before I get into other things, and I apologize to all the linguists here. But it will be a very personal take on linguistics, so here's what I hope to fit into this talk. And I'll start with a prologue and send you all my greetings from my own Academy of Sciences, the Societas Scientiarum Fennica, the Finnish Society of Sciences and Letters, and hope for future cooperation in the name of science. Now, up until the 1960s, there was a fair consensus among linguists about what a natural language is. As Ruth also said, the term human language was not often explicitly used. I mean, natural was human. Natural language was typically tied to human speakers, writers, using a communicative system that they had prototypically learned in childhood from their parents. And of course, gradually then we get into all other kinds of fields of interest, including bonobos and gorillas and so forth. Not a whole lot of bats yet, but we'll get there. And I could say a lot about these things. And basically, just I want to say that the field of linguistics today encompasses much more than what we saw as our field of research some 50 years ago. And this is an excellent place to sort of talk about these things. Okay, very briefly about linguistics, and this is to oversimplify greatly. In the 20th century, and of course before that, the whole idea was to get linguistics to be established and accepted as a science. We had a lot of rules and laws and things, and the positivistic logic rule, the rational mind, the classics, the written language was the ideal language that we should pay heed to and look at to see how language works. We got into debate between mentalism and mechanism, or behaviorism and mentalism, and in particular, of course, Noam Chomsky's transformational generative grammar was by some seen as a paradigm shift in linguistics, and where he also created different modules or components for sound and word and sentence structure. And he also brought up linguistics into discussions about what our theory should do, whether it should only be observationally adequate, descriptively adequate, or also have explanatory adequacy, which is what he hoped for. So basically, there was a search for the true essence of language. And these Chomsky's and other people's components are, of course, okay as tools of analysis, but for me, we should want to get at an understanding of language, and that's what I want to talk about today. So, I suppose in many approaches today, the predominant view in many parts of linguistics is to put interaction in the center. And interaction is, of course, important, and so is cognition. But for me as a linguist, the big question is, what is it that makes language special? What is it that experts on language need to know in addition to what scholars in psychology and sociology and so forth investigate? So we start out by language as having form, meaning, and function. And in order to understand all of these things, we really have to approach language from several perspectives at the same time. I'm just here giving an overview of things here, not only putting in semiotics and poetics and so forth, but also geometry, biology, and so forth. And this is, of course, very appropriate for the whole day-to-day of what's happening in language, also for linguists, I think. So we not only have to approach it from different sort of disciplines, but also from the basic approaches and methods that are used in scientific research. This is just a overview of Habermas's distinction between different kinds of empirical, analytic, and historical hermeneutic, and social sciences, and the different approaches of deductive, inductive, and so forth, ways of doing linguistics. But all of these are ultimately very important and need to be taken into account kind of in parallel in order to get a global or sort of gestalt understanding of what language is. And these different perspectives that are necessary for a full understanding have resulted in an abundance of different approaches, models, theories, whatever you call them, within linguistics. And that in turn has meant that we have a lot of sub-disciplines within linguistics, and unfortunately they don't always talk to each other. The typical thing is to sort of look at linguistics from these points of view. We have the typical phonetics, phonology, morphology, syntax, lexicology, semantics, and pragmatics. And some of them deal more with form, others with meaning, usually meaning and form, and others with function and meaning. But then there's always people who say, well, prosody doesn't really fit in under phonetics, and we need some further subdisciplines here, and different ways of looking at it, sociolinguistics, neurolinguistics, cognitive linguistics, and so forth, and different ways of doing it with corpus analysis or not. And then there are things on the fringes. Does onomastics really belong here? Is names really part of linguistics? For me, yes, of course. But there are all these things going on. Now, basically, I think we can say that we've gone from a monological way of looking at language through a dialogical, and then maybe today I would hope that we're more in a sort of cultural coherence way of looking at what language really is. The general problem, I think, with this situation is that it fosters a view of language where we can split up language and chop out a piece, and then as scholars also feel that it's okay to work on only one part, say on syntax or on names, and only make sort of fluffy remarks about, well, context will take care of that, we'll do that tomorrow. And this way of seeing language in terms of modules, of course, it has its basis in references to the makeup of the brain and so forth, which I don't know much about, and these studies are important, but they kind of refrain from approaching language as we or as I know it. That is, I think what I think linguists should be doing. So I don't really like modules, sorry. At present, there's a lot of discussion about interfaces between components, what kinds of components I just mentioned. To my mind, these are simply fabrications necessitated by the framework that is set up. Interfaces aren't there in language, to my mind, in language use, in language structure, in meaning. For me, language is one. Still, there are different perspectives, but they all work together kind of all the time. So what we have then are also what Ruth Berman mentioned here, what I and many others, following the groundbreaking work of Charles Fillmore, is what we call constructions, generalizations over instances of language use that are the resources that we have at our disposal when we communicate. So that everything in language can be expressed as constructions, words, grammatical structure, rhetorical structure, whatever. And in order to represent constructions, we've adopted, or some of us have adopted, following Fillmore, the simplistic attribute value matrices, really just a way of representation. The actual format of representation is arbitrary, but it's useful for analytic purposes. So to take a simple example here, if we want to say that a word is a noun, we specify the attribute, the perspective as word class, and then give it the value noun out of number of values that it can take. And it's important to figure out what these possible values are. At the same time, the word can have the value subject within the attribute grammatical function. It can have the value agent with respect to the attribute semantic role or theta role or whatever you call it. So the analysis of an expression like Sam bought a house can then look something like this. This is an analysis then of an instance of language, which we call that a construct, whereas then the resources we used are the abstract constructions. And what I want you to notice here is that the attributes and values are embedded in each other. Here is a whole information about the whole noun phrase, a house, and then we have, that's called the external specification attributes, and then we have specifications about the internal attributes and values about the house here. And I want you to sort of keep that in mind because it's going to be important for what I want to say. Now, this is fairly important with nouns and verbs, and Chomsky and others would say that, well, that's just a notational variant. But anyway, perhaps the most challenging of these approaches to language and communication has been pragmatics. And especially if we add context, then many linguists will say that this is outside of language proper. My take on linguistics is quite the opposite. I want to build context into grammar. And before I show you how I want to do that, I'll say a couple of words about pragmatics very briefly. But in scholars' attempts to be scientific, focus was placed on those aspects of language that were amenable to this, to that kind of thinking, morphology and syntax. Language itself, or the why of language, was lost on the way. And only in the mid-1970s, pragmatics started to be recognized and rectified. Of course, there were precursors like the ordinary language philosophy and even the Stoics, but mainstream linguists had kept away. So in the 1980s, the International Pragmatics Association was established, now with a journal, biannual conferences with over 1,000 delegates. The next one is in Belfast this summer. Please come and join us. And Charles Morris was deemed the father of linguistic pragmatics. And Charles Morris said in 1938 that pragmatics deals with all the psychological, biological, and sociological phenomena which occur in the functioning of signs. Now, that's huge. I mean, it encompasses everything, basically. But he also made this basic distinction between syntax, semantics, and pragmatics, where pragmatics has just as good or respectable part in language study as the other two. And the International Pragmatics Association has kind of followed suit and also has a very broad definition of pragmatics as a functional, that is, cognitive, social, and cultural perspective on language and communication. Now, that sounds good, but what is it really then? How do we get a hold on language function, and how can we represent context systematically? We don't want it to be an unsystematic rag bag that we can always refer to or sort of blame if something doesn't work. We know, or we think, linguists, most of us at least, that the only thing constant in language is change. Language varies according to age, education, gender, lifestyle, background, etc., etc. And we also know that language and language use are governed by ideologies. I prefer to talk about them as responsibilities, because responsibilities bring in agents. They're not just something fluffy out there. Power and language is very often tied together. So, you know, if these are the aspects or the perspectives that we need to take into account in order to get a holistic picture of language, shouldn't we just put them in our analysis? And now we have a system for doing that, the attribute value matrices. And so in the same way as a noun phrase is an external specification of what goes on internally, then these aspects can also be inserted as extremely external features that affect language structure and meaning, since we're now in the process of building context into grammar. These are just some random features as external attributes, where the boxes inside them will specify the internal features. We know from previous research that we at least need to take these perspectives into account, the age and gender and so forth. Sorry, I won't be able to get into these in any detail, but I'll give you the idea. Now, in addition, of course, as my title said also, variability, variation, and adaptability need to be taken into account. We need to find a way of representing a variability also, and this is just from Verschuren's work on these aspects, and basically adaptability has been very central in work on pragmatics, the enabling human beings to make negotiable choices from the variable range of possibilities so as to satisfy basic human communicative needs and so forth. And in addition to all of this, I would like to also introduce the implicit in language, the implicitness. And I'll say a little bit more about that, because for me that is the most important thing about what pragmatics should be dealing with. Because if the only thing constant in language is change, then one of the core questions of linguistics must be to find out how language change takes place. And there's a lot of studies about causes and processes and even results of language change, but really I want to know what is it that drives change and how does this work? How does the why of change work? And my take on this is that we need to distinguish between realize that language functions in parallel on two levels, the explicit and the implicit. People and experts on consciousness went here, I would talk about this as conscious and subconscious. Now I don't dare to use those words, but basically that's how I think of things. So this is just to give you an overview of we need to make a distinction between the things that this is what we linguistics usually deals with, the micro perspective of the explicit, and sometimes the text linguists and others will go into this field and patterns of argumentation, but the whole field of implicitness with the interactional practices, praxis and expressions of affect comes in here, and ideology, tradition and culture comes in there. And that is what I think that pragmatics should be dealing with. And the notion of implicitness gives me the opportunity to take you to my part of the world. This is the Nordic countries, as you know. I'll just show you the relevance of this distinction. Swedish language, Finland, is this sort of thing in red here in the enlargement. As you know, Finland has two national languages and so forth. Now, in a large study of in the Nordic countries, informants were asked about their use of English, their opinions about English as a global language, and so forth. And these were two of the questions that the informants had to respond to. Do people use too many English words in Swedish today? And this is for Finland Swedish. Do we need to create new Swedish words to replace the English words? And the questions were asked in an opinion poll and in focus group interviews and so forth. And in these investigations, Finland Swedes were rather negative towards English. You can see here that, yes, there are too many English words. We need to replace them. And also here in the interviews, that we need to replace them. Not so clearly too many of them, because that can be interpreted in different ways. But people in general were negative towards English. But we also did match Geist tests where five texts were read out as stimuli, and two of these were by the same person, and informants were then asked to evaluate the voices on a 7-point Likert scale with respect to whether the speaker sounded ambitious, intelligent, independent, efficient, pleasing, trustful, interesting, relaxed. And these here are the Geist's, or the two texts that the same person read, and in bold you can see the differences between the text. And the results show then that the version with a couple of English words was felt to be much more positive for all the character traits and for interesting and efficient. This difference was statistically significant, with a tendency to significance for ambitious and independent. So really, actually, people like English, but you're not supposed to say that. So there's something going on between the lines that you don't hear them ever say. And that, you see the difference here that if you're asked about your explicit opinions, you're pretty negative, but you're tested for the implicit attitudes. They're pretty positive towards loan words in English. And I can mention that the results for Danish was the actual opposite. I mean, so it doesn't have anything to do with positive and negative with English in general. So we clearly, to my mind, need to make a distinction between explicit and opinions and implicit attitudes and how these are expressed in language. And by extension, then, I think this distinction also becomes relevant for all aspects of language and communication. And in a number of studies, we've also found that it's the implicitness of language, the stuff that takes place between the lines, that drives the process of language change. So at least we need to look at it systematically and even test whether this is the case, but that's what we found so far. And these two levels aren't sort of separate. I mean, they work in parallel. They interact, they inform each other, and so forth. So I've devised a thing that I call pragmatics as implicit anchoring, where I try to make the distinction between meaning as the explicit in language, the kinds of things that have been codified, whereas then the function of language is the implicit that pragmatics should take care of, what takes place between the lines of what one says and what you find, what's implicitly present in an utterance. Okay, I see I'm running out of time. Let's see now. Here's just how that it gets manifested, and we need to generalize and operationalize that. And the three things that I've started out with are these three dimensions of language function that I take as a heuristic starting point: the sociocultural coherence, the interactive politeness, or whatever you call it, and the involvement and engagement. And we need at least to do something with them, so let's just put them in. And in relation to what I said also about implicitness, that can also sort of be, this is where it would come in together with other things. And what I've said so far now is really a way of saying why I talk about these things. In my life, I've been dealing, on the one hand, with all these sort of general issues of language function, the text and discourse, appropriation, vitalized migrants and so forth, language contact, and on the other hand, the grammar that I just mentioned, and how to combine these two, how to get at the yin and yang of language. And there is a lot of these variability, but it's restrained. So I'm really a structuralist at heart, and I wanted to sort of make this systematic, and rather than asking, maybe as a conversation analyst would say, why this now, I want to know what is the alternative, what choices do speakers and researchers have. So in the same way as we simultaneously choose for an element to be a noun, a subject, and an agent, we also choose values on the contextual attributes, and that gives it flexibility, the combination of these values on these attributes. I'm trying to sort of integrate these contextual factors, and I don't like... like to put them into grammar and not talk about fragments and ellipses at all. I don't think that these things are important. I want to sort of integrate pragmatics and discourse within construction, and that's why I call this construction discourse, and get away from thinking of language in terms of there being a sort of, you know, that you always have to start out with the active, positive, finite, declarative, transitive clause and then see how everything else differs from that in a negative way. No, that's not what construction grammar would do. So we need to have make meticulous, detailed analysis of all kinds of structures that will give us understanding of the whole of language. And I had an example here, but I probably won't be able to do it, but it's sort of Wellerisms, like it all comes back to me now, said the captain as he spat into the wind. And the good thing about this is that you know that if you say the captain said it all comes back to me now as he spat into the wind, it's not a Wellerism anymore. It doesn't function as a Wellerism. So there's and the typical question that a linguist would ask, of course, of a sentence like this is what is the constituent structure, and typically you would say, okay, there's subject and predicate and object or something like that, but really if you don't start out with that, but you look at the usage of language, you get a different picture. So you really get a picture where object is one constituent, subject and finite verb is one constituent, and the rest is another constituent. That's against all that we know about language, but that is what usage tells us to do. So again, I was going to take you to my little village here, but that's just because these Wellerisms are all around in the world, and you can, in order to find out the functions of them, because that's what we want to get at, here is some kinds of things that I've found out having to do with identity and humor and accountability. You can swear a lot if you use it as a Wellerist, but otherwise swearing is not what you do. So you get a general picture of this is then how I would represent a Wellerism, at least in the language that I know of at now, at the present. And the general big picture then of the full picture of the external attributes would look something like there. Here we have the construction packaging that Bracha has worked on. Here we have all the sort of register stuff, and that needs to be looked into in detail. Okay, so I'm going to finish. I wanted to say something about universality, because typically when we classify languages, we start by the form of it and do all these genetic and aerial topological things, but we also need to look at it from the functional view, and Steve Levinson, is in his recent quest for finding the origin of language, really feels that the only real universality is this interactional infrastructure for communication, which is exclusive to humans. And that would take me into language and culture and so forth. But language is variable, but it's restrained. And now I'm going to finish. Thank you very much.
But we can have one short question, please. Somebody want to comment or question? Yeah? Somebody there?
Okay. Okay, that's so good. Let me just go on. No, this one up there in the back.
In the back? Yes. Please. Avital.
I wonder if you could comment on the possibility of implicit in a world of a huge migration as we see now.
Well, that is exactly what I'm working on at the moment. I'm looking at the role of language really in refugees and in migration in particular, and how that has to deal with, well, integration more like that, and what goes on in the sort of identity construction that's going on. In my case, I'm looking at how people come to very, very small communities, and it's a sort of communities that are in the minorities of a minority of a minority, and they still sort of, they're very well taken care of, and they live a beautiful life, but of course, at the same time, they're being closed out from the majority of the community that I'm looking at. But I think that what happens is that they're creating a kind of, what Baba would say, a sort of third position that's not the sort of position of where they come from or where they are, but sort of trying to find an identity someplace else. And that's where I see the implicitness being very forceful way of describing this and talking about this. Yes.
Thank you very much indeed.